Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be talking through some of the specifics of the main anterior thorax muscles. And when I say thorax, or think, I want you to think between the neck and the abdomen. So that area there that has the rib cage and part of the vertebral column. These three muscles are going to be the two pectoralis muscles, major and minor, as well as serratus anterior. So let's start with pectoralis major muscle, which is this large fan-shaped muscle, which has two proximal attachments, or we like to call these two heads of the muscle. You will have a clavicular head, which you can see here. It is going to, as its name would suggest, attach to the clavicle. And a sternocostal head, which you can see is the larger one. And this will attach to the sternum, aka that breastbone, and the costal cartilages, which are how the ribs attach to the sternum. The distal attachment is on the proximal humerus, so you can't really see the bone here, but you can see that it is heading towards the arm, so it is going to attach specifically to the crest of the greater tubercle of the humerus. So looking at these attachment points, you can see that the pectoralis major muscle will cross the glenohumeral joint, which would be about here. And so since it crosses the glenohumeral or the shoulder joint, when it contracts, it can directly affect some of the actions that occur at the shoulder joint. Speaking of actions, the pectoralis major muscle can do quite a lot, but it is dependent on which part of the muscle is contracting, because the clavicular and the sternocostal heads can actually contract simultaneously or separately. So when contracting at the same time, this will cause the shoulder joint or arm to adduct. All right, so just think this muscle gets shorter and it would lead the arm to adduct or move more towards the midline. It will also, or it can also medially rotate the shoulder region. So that means that anterior portion of the arm will kind of rotate medially. And there are some excellent videos in the BlueLink resources showing these actions and the other major joints of the body. So if you want to kind of look at what that looks like, I'd highly recommend those, and it'll be a link in the learning objective text. When only this clavicular head contracts, so when it contracts by itself or alone, it can flex the shoulder joint or bring the arm anteriorly, kind of towards us. Not down, sorry. I should say it's kind of hard to draw that because it's coming anteriorly in the sagittal plane. Whereas the opposite happens when the sternocostal head contracts alone, which will extend the shoulder, moving it back towards anatomical position from that flex position, or past anatomical position in a more posterior direction. So kind of move your arm anteriorly, that's flexion, and if you move your arm posteriorly, that's going to be extension. All right. Now let's discuss the neurovascular supply of pectoralis major. And both the lateral and medial pectoral nerves will provide efferent and afferent innervation for this muscle. So you can see the lateral pectoral nerve here. I'm outlining it here. And the medial is going to be here and here. You can see it piercing through pec minor. Usually just one nerve will innervate a muscle, but in cases where there's a larger muscle, like what we have with pectoralis major, there may be two nerves. So that's the case here. And both of these nerves will originate from the brachial plexus. More to come on the brachial plexus, much, much more in upcoming blocks. The arterial supply will be from the thoracoacromial artery. And this is actually quite a large artery. I'm circling it right here. And it has lots of branches, and some of those will head towards the pectoralis major as well as the minor to provide blood. And this is a branch of the axillary artery, which is an important major artery of the arm. Since this muscle is so large, it has a few important anatomical or clinical relationships. It will form the anterior wall of the axilla, and we like to kind of refer to the axilla as the armpit region. Additionally, the investing deep fascia that will surround the muscle is called pectoral fascia, And this muscle and its associated fascia is very closely associated with the breast, which is just anterior to the pectoralis major and its fascia. So there, if there's any type of breast pathology or surgery in that region that needs to be done, this muscle or its fascia or its neurovasculature may be affected, or the muscle may need to be resected or moved to get to some of the deeper structures around there. All right, moving on to the pectoralis minor muscle, which is just deep to the much larger pectoralis major. So if pectoralis major was here, it'd be kind of like right around this region going this way, and it would completely cover the pectoralis minor. The muscle's proximal attachments are on the anterior surfaces of ribs 3 through 5. Odd-looking three there. And the distal attachment is on the scapula, specifically the coracoid process. So you can see here that it does not cross the shoulder joint, and the shoulder joint would be right here. So it does not cross the shoulder joint. So it will not have a direct effect on the shoulder joint, but it will certainly have an indirect effect. Instead, the pectoralis minor muscle will affect the scapulothoracic joint. And anytime you see something in quotes like I have here, that should raise your eyebrows. And so what is the scapulothoracic joint? It's probably not one you've heard of before. Well, it's not a typical synovial joint like the shoulder, the elbow, or the wrist. Instead, what we're describing here is more the movements of the scapula on the thoracic cage. So the thoracic cage is the rib cage, basically connected to the sternum and the vertebrae. And so it's basically how that scapula move in comparison to the thorax. And you can see an image that kind of shows a breakdown of the different types of movements that can occur of the scapula. And it's these movements that will also help facilitate a full range of motion at the shoulder joint. So you need that scapula to move in order to have that full range of motion. Say, get your arm all the way, you know, pointing all the way up, that you need the scapula to move as well. Specifically, pectoralis minor muscle will play a big role in overall stabilization of the scapula. And what I mean here is that it will keep the scapula kind of locked down or in place while other upper limb joints move. So that's what we mean by stabilization. But when more forceful contracting of the pectoralis minor muscle occurs, this can also play a role in terms of protraction, or moving that scapula more anteriorly and laterally. Protraction is sometimes referred to as abduction of the scapula. The neurovasculature is very similar to that of the pectoralis major muscle. The only substantial difference is that only the medial pectoral nerve will innervate pec minor. And a very notable relationship is that additionally, the medial pectoral nerve will actually pierce directly through the pectoralis minor muscle as it heads to the more superficial pectoralis major. So if you had hypertrophy of the pectoralis minor muscle, to a very large extent, it could feasibly pinch on the medial pectoral nerve. Another important relationship is that the pectoralis minor muscle will subdivide the axillary artery, which is right here, and it will subdivide it into three parts. So you can see pec minor muscle's tendon right here. It would kind of continue this way over here to the ribs. And what it will do is you can see that the belly would be located kind of right here, and the axillary artery will be described based on its relationship to the pectoralis minor. So is this portion would be medial to it, that would be the first part. This would be the second part, that would be deep to pec minor. And then this part lateral to it would be the third part. Don't worry so much about first, second, and third part. We'll come back to that later on in the musculoskeletal content, but this is an important relationship, an anatomical relationship of pectoralis minor. Lastly, we have the serratus anterior muscle, which is going to lie over a fairly substantial part of the lateral part of the thorax, and it has this very sawtoothed appearance, which is actually where it gets its name, the serrated type of appearance, with these little slips of muscle. which are actually not that little. They're actually fairly robust. And this muscle will proximally attach to the superior most rib, 8 ribs, so ribs 1 through 8, and it will distally attach to a large portion or the majority of this anterior portion of the scapula. So this is posterior, so it'd be on this anterior part. So again, this muscle is not crossing the shoulder joint and will more directly affect the movement of the scapula. Serratus anterior is actually an extremely powerful muscle and is a very powerful protractor of the scapula, more so than pectoralis minor. So a boxer may have a hypertrophied serratus anterior muscle, so it may be more built up, because punching involves protraction of the scapula. So kind of try to punch your arm out, and that scapula will be moving kind of lateral and anterior. The more inferior portions of serratus anterior will rotate the glenoid cavity, which is the part that attaches or that articulates with the humerus. It will rotate that glenoid cavity of the scapula upwards, and this will really allow the arm to be able to be raised above the shoulder. So this is what I'm talking about, how pectoralis minor and serratus anterior are directly affecting the scapula, but it will play an indirect role in terms of the glenohumeral joint. It can also play a role in overall stability of the scapula. Serratus anterior is innervated by the long thoracic nerve, which is also a branch of the brachial plexus. And this nerve is very uniquely placed. So most nerves are going to be located deep to the muscle it innervates. But this is not the case for the long thoracic, which runs right down the superficial portion of the muscle. And so just thinking about this, this would make this nerve more susceptible to injury. Think of a stabbing injury to the side of the body or that side of the thorax, but also in surgeries around this region or around the axillary region, so like an axillary lymphatic node dissection or surgery, that could directly affect or cause a lesion or a kind of nick to the long thoracic nerve, and thus that would affect the actions of the serratus anterior. And this would lead to what is called a winged scapula, which is going to cause the scapula to be visibly displaced posterolaterally, supposedly resembling wings. And this can greatly affect scapular motion, but also shoulder joint movement. And this, I have a star here. I'm going to put another star here and maybe another star here. This anatomical clinical relationship of that long thoracic nerve causing, or a lesion of the long thoracic nerve causing what's referred to as a winged scapula, is one of those things that very often come up, not only on your upcoming assessments, but also some of those step tests that I'm sure you may have heard of. So this is one of those classic anatomical clinical relationships. All right, we have made it to the end and to our summary slide. These are those really big picture, high yield concepts we want you to walk away with. As you review, please always feel free to reach out with any questions, and thank you for your time and attention.